So this is a session on sports engineering methods for sports science presented by Adidas. And originally this session was arranged and organized by Björn Oskov. He couldn't come today for a special reason. And I would like to show you a photo that he just sent us this morning with his best regards. And I'm sure that you all understand why he couldn't come today. This will be his third child, and it should have been come to Earth a week ago. And for this case, he decided not to come here, and I think this is clearly understandable. This leaves it to me to organize or to share the session. And fortunately, Björn sent us a colleague, Stefan Kradl, who will do his talk in this session. And I'm really thankful that he made it in just the last second to get here and to make this presentation so that we could present all three themes. So just before we start, so I just have to introduce myself, Thomas Jeitner, TU Dortmund, and together we will share this. And if you want to contact Stefan, then you should just notice it's Björn at the moment, so we didn't get him a proper note there. Yeah, well, this session, as I said, is sponsored by Adidas, and I would like, just at the beginning, like to thank Bertolt Grubber, who's over there in the audience, for sponsoring this session. And yeah, well, this allows us to present some new research and a good overview about sports engineering at its current state of the art. And what we will hear today are three talks. The first one from Valentina Camomilla will be on inertial sensors and their applications on sports as well as for injury prevention. And we will then go on with a second talk from the group of Björn Oskov here, which will expand the theme to other sources of data as well as the algorithms and methods to analyze these huge amounts of data and bring them to an application which can be used by consumers. And our last talk will be presented by Veit Zenner, and he will focus on methods and models that allow us to address research problems that we often cannot address by experiments, and he will show disadvantages and strategies how these problems can be approached. For last organizational point is that we just decided to first present all three papers or all three topics, and then we have a discussion at the end of the session for all three papers. So now I would like to call Valentina on the stage, and we will start with her first presentation. So we need to, I have to change this, and we need to have, yeah, that's all right, we have the slide changed. So Valentina, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Can you hear me? Okay. So my aim today is to give you an overview of the use of wearable magneto-inertial sensors. There are many sensors on the market, but I will focus only on them, to hopefully give you an idea of the many possible applications in the domain of sport, both sport performance, risk of injury, motor capacity, and I will base my talk on a review of the state of the art. I'm sure everybody now will agree that motor magneto-inertial technology is now timely to characterize both sport performance and risk of injury without influencing performance, at least not excessively so. And many contexts do allow the use of sensors even in competition. But before moving to the applications, I will briefly summarize what are these sensors and which are the features so that we can match the problems and characteristics of the sensors to the applications. We have accelerometers and gyroscopes, which are proper inertia sensors because the principle of functioning is based off the inertia principle. And they are often cited by magnetometers, whose aim will be explained in a minute. Accelerometers measure linear acceleration along their sensitive axis, while gyroscopes measure angular velocity about the sensitive axis. And magnetometers provide us with the magnetic field. So how can we use this information to measure the body human movement? Accelerometers measure the proper linear acceleration, meaning that they have a center of mass acceleration, but they provide us with the difference of this acceleration with respect to gravity. This means that if the sensor is in free fall, I measure zero. If the sensor is still, I measure gravity. In terms of relevance of this information, we know that a sensor which is inclined with respect to the vertical has an output which is proportional to gravity in terms of cosine alpha. What does it mean? If we want to measure the acceleration of the center of mass of the sensor, which may be associated with the center of mass of the body, we need to get rid of the acceleration of gravity. We need to remove gravity, which in turn means that we need to know the inclination of the sensor. How can we obtain the inclination of these sensors? Well, we can combine the information that are obtained from accelerometers and gyroscopes, since the first provide us with inclination in static or quasi-static conditions, and the second can give us angular displacement by integration of angular velocity. In the second case, of course, we need to know where the sensor starts from in integration. And that leads us to the integration of the two sensors to have orientation both in static and dynamic conditions. So if we have two orthogonal accelerometers and one gyroscope orthogonal to them, we can have 2D kinematics, which means the orientation with respect to gravity in space. If we're interested on having an absolute orientation, however, we might want to combine the information with that provided by magnetometers. If they give us the orientation of the magnetic north field, then we can have the orientation of the sensors with respect to it, meaning that we also have EO. Well then, given this overview, what can we measure with these sensors? I don't know if you are half full, half empty glass people, but I want to share with you how I feel about these sensors. I see them as half full and half full. They are all full of problems, but they're also all full of ideas, of possible solutions. And I'm neither an all full or half empty person. I think that we need to be aware of problems to get to the wine, so, or whatever you want to drink. So I will first describe the problems to then move on to the applications. First, but not most important, I mean, we have three problems and I would give them equal importance, is drift. Gyroscopes, aside from bias, which can be easily removed, in time accumulate noise, which is variable in an unpredictable way, which calls for compensation of this problem that would lead otherwise in changes, huge changes in orientation. And I said that magnetometers should provide us with magnetic field, but this is not a tremendous power leading field. So if there is other sources of ferromagnetic disturbances, we could have a reorientation of the magnetic field that would completely spoil the role of magnetometers in providing us with an absolute orientation. Last but not least, in sports, in dynamic context, we need to be aware that sensors are not rigidly attached to the bones. If we want to track the skeleton movement, soft tissues and fixing will be in between the sensor and the bone and provide with the damped oscillations that could be misinterpreted. So being aware of these three problems, and I will try to match the problems with the applications, let's move on to see trends, issues, and potential guidelines to use these sensors for both sport performance and risk of injury prevention. We performed, when I say we, it's a group of authors I will present at the end. We performed a systematic review of the literature, including all papers that dealt with athletes performing a motor task in a sport context using inertia sensors. And we refined the search for risk of injury, selecting papers dealing with the prevention of it. this is the results. We obtained a huge number of papers, 270, dealing with sport performance and 88 with risk of injury. And we further divided them in technique analysis, capacity assessment, match analysis, and activity classification. Of course, this classification will come in a minute. But in general terms, the trend of this literature is to have an incredible, a huge amount of papers in the last 3 years that almost tripled the interest of the scientific community for sport performance research, while risk of injury remains more or less stable through the years, the recent years. As expected, the athlete level included in this study covers 70% of athletes from an elite or a sub-elite classification level, which may be justified by the interest of describing technique at a higher level. And at the same time, it's not strange that 70% of the papers of the studies were performed in field or during competition. Simulated competition were included in the in-field part, because only few sports allow real competition with sensors. In this image, you can see the location used to place the sensors and the different types. We can go from monoaxial accelerometers to a complete magneto-inertial sensor with 3D accelerometer, magnetometer, and a gyroscope. And positioning depends on the use of a single sensor, typically placed on the trunk, or multiple sensors placed on the upper and lower limbs to describe joint kinematics. Of course, this applies as well from the frontal for the frontal view, and for sensors placed on the objects or within the objects. This is typical for studies that are interested in assessing locomotion, characterizing the means of locomotion, or for striking or when protection are entailed. So let's give a closer look at the two different areas. Talking about sport performance, I highlighted in yellow the sports where without wearable we wouldn't be able to properly ecologically perform an analysis. We see that there are many sports represented. I clustered them to give you an idea, and the widest part of the cake is represented by cyclic sports with running, swimming, cycling, and rowing. I think for two reasons. One is that these sports are widely practiced, but also because identifying events that could set the cycles is not so difficult using these sensors. Another huge area is represented by team sports, where match analysis approaches make the most part of this 25%, and motor capacity as another 20%, while winter sports and other individual sports have 10% each. Starting from sport technique analysis, I will give you an overview of this area, thinking of parameters, because if you are aware of the parameters can be reliably assessed, this can trigger your imagination and potentially think of further applications. The most simple features that we can extract using this sensor are obviously related with time or with spatiotemporal parameters. The first thing we need to do to perform a proper technique analysis in sports biomechanics is setting different phases of the task apart or measure critical events. All the examples I'm showing come from the literature we found, and the references are only the reviews that we found. So in these examples, we have complex tasks that are being segmented in many different sub-phases, but this could be also very simple cyclic events detection that could lead, although simple measures, to analyzing pacing strategies over a long race. Moving on to general kinematic variables, you see we have distances, velocities, and acceleration. The different variables have elicit different problems, because you remember we measure acceleration to obtain velocity and displacement. We need first to get rid of gravity and second to integrate, which carries on the error that I mentioned. So in this area of kinematic variables, many different possible strategies are implemented to cope with the problems. So in no case, the simple integration of the signal will lead to the information you're searching for. You might assume that there is a starting point which is cyclically coming back and removing a mean value of the velocity you are searching. For example, if you want the instantaneous velocity of the center of mass, a possible solution is to assume that within the cycle, the velocity is constant, which is not often the case if you are sprinting, for example. Or limit the analysis to average velocities. If we move to displacements, the problem is even worse because you have a double integration in place. But again, there are many studies that find possible strategies to cope with the problem, meaning that the problem is not always solvable, but in the literature we found the niches where the sensors could provide with reasonable information. Reasonable may be that center of mass displacement is tracked when you are going downhill and you're tracking a bicycle, so an error of a meter wouldn't be important with respect to the general application. If you're interested in the centimeter error, well then you might not be able to use these sensors to obtain the displacement. And finally, to close the kinematic section, you can detect specific events, such impacts at the ground or strokes with the tools like a tennis racket. Then the core business of these sensors in technique analysis, aside from detecting cycles, for me is detecting orientation, which could be absolute relative orientation of a single segment or relative orientation of two segments, leading to joint kinematics. There are many studies that are using this approach. But remember, the gyroscope was integrated with the accelerometer, providing orientation with respect to gravity. This is the most reliable information in terms of orientation. When the magnetometer comes in place and you have the yaw, so the orientation on the horizontal plane, then you need to be aware of the limits of the magnetometer and of the context in which the measures is performed. If it is outdoor and you don't have ferromagnetic disturbances, then the yaw will be reliable. If it's indoor or you have disturbances, you could limit yourself to assessing roll and pitch. And in the different applications, again, this problem has been acknowledged and sometimes compensated with assumptions such as I start the movement in the same position in which the movement will end. So I have some modeling information that could supplement the problems of the sensors. And this applies as well to joint kinematics. I'm keeping it simple. This is 100 papers and each of them find a specific solution to the problems I'm mentioning. But there's very many fields of application where joint kinematics has been assessed, like running or kicking, or in contexts in winter sports where really assessing human movement with other methods would be really very difficult, if not impossible. Last but not least, in terms of kinematics and orientation, is the kinematics that regards the objects with which the athletes interact. The difference between this slide and the previous one is that wobbling is not part of the picture. And remember, in dynamic tasks, the movement of the sensor with respect to the body, the soft tissue roll, it may be important. For objects, of course, we don't have this problem. And if we are able to use technology to embed the sensors within the objects and to transmit proper information, then this is the most reliable information we can get in the overall kinematics picture. Moving on to dynamics, there are a few studies assessing dynamic variables, I would say some 20 papers, all of them relying on inverse dynamics approach, some of them in winter sports also relying on the integration of some pressure or force sensors within the skis or boots and performing an hybrid inverse dynamics. But I think there's space for development of further application in this area, which suffers from the problem of determining points, positions, because if we want to get to joint movement moments, we need to have the position of the joint center to have reliable estimates. So to sum up the technique analysis part, in red you see which variables should require further development or need to have specific assumptions to help you through the estimate of the related quantities, while in green we have those that can be reliably estimated. So the last line was not commented. I just listed work and power, but I left it for now, because in model capacity assessment, which means a standardized test that can allow the performance of the athlete to be assessed in a capacity perspective, we often see studies that assess power, which can be tested either through jumping activities or while performing some weightlifting activities, eccentric or concentric. So this is the most of the studies on capacity. But also there are some others that simply assess spatiotemporal parameters, which quantitatively support the tests that are usually performed on the field, but only provide a single timing as a descriptor. Moving on to match analysis, the role of accelerometer here is ancillary to that of GPS systems that came into place after GPS to set apart the different intensities of the task. But I think that center of mass kinematics and jerk, which is called frequent player load, to measure external load, can be complemented by further information about what is happening at that intensity. And this could open up perspectives in the further understanding how the external load affects the performance in match analysis. And also, the role of the accelerometers is characterizing physical collision characteristics, not only the number, but also type and intensity. That could be important both from a risk of injury perspective and mainly from a performance perspective. Last but not least, we have a group of papers that give a call to Stephen, because he will talk about classification, I guess. In this studies, the role of senses is that of identifying which activity has been performed with different levels of complexity, for example, setting apart different techniques within the same sport or classifying across different tasks. And in this category, I also placed some 6-7 papers we call platypus, not classifiable. We put them in the classification section. Moving on to the risk of injury prevention, you see that the picture is slightly changed with respect to the sports represented in the sport performance. Of course, the interest in preventing the risk of injury is shifted towards specific districts or to specific applications that can be targeted by using these sensors. Contact in sports as the main part of the picture, with 60% of the studies. These studies are mostly focused on head impacts and concussion, but not only. While the locomotion studies are interested in assessing the role of impacts in propagating through the kinematic chain up to the head. I will tell a little bit more in a minute. And of course, combat sports as a space as well, because of the head impacts in this sports. So risk of injury studies, I describe them with two different perspectives. One is that of trying to understand, describe the injury mechanisms and the prescriptive factors in a real environment. And we have three main areas. One was already mentioned, is that of concussions, where sensors do not exactly allow to describe the injury mechanisms, but are sometimes used to have indication of the prevalence or the classification of the events as potentially leading to a concussion. And the description of vibration is, of course, another typical area of application of this technology, accelerometers. I don't know if you noticed it, but there are some studies in the early 80s where only accelerometers were used, while gyroscopes were miniaturized only in the last 15, 20 years. And vibrations has been the typical field of application since many years. In terms of landings and changes of direction, abrupt decelerations of the body, the studies try to understand what is the effect of this deceleration going up the kinetic chain in terms of ankle sprains or tibial shock effects, which are typical parameters that can lead to stress fracture injuries or to injuries that can be non-contact injuries for the anterior cruciate ligament, but also there is interest in assessing the consequences of foot strike up to the back and the head. Another point of view, which is less covered but still important in this literature, is that of looking at protective devices. So sensors are an aid to complement protective devices. And in the area of head concussions, the helmets with instrumented sensors could be helpful in the characterization of frequency, magnitude, and location of the impacts, combining rotational accelerations, which has been proved to be important, as well as linear accelerations in characterizing the type of impact and the consequences in terms of brain injuries, and also measuring the pressure between the helmet and the head. As it regards the footwear, the role in this literature of sensors within the footwear is of two types. One is related to the characterization of shock attenuation, but also they can be used to describe joint kinematics in order to assess the role of the shoe to perform a better or worse ankle stabilization. And there are also a couple of studies in which accelerometers act as a predictor of the ankle sprain and activate a sort of airbag that protects the structure. Last but not least, gait retraining is another area covered by this literature, where feedback systems based on the use of sensors, apologies for markers here, I couldn't find a decent picture with inertia sensors, but the literature uses also inertia sensors to provide the runner or the walker, but specifically runners, with a feedback that can help them change their running mechanics and reduce the risk of injury with specific ACL or tibia stress fracture risks. So to sum up what came out from this systematic review, the current trend is to increasingly investigate elite and sub-elite athletes. The technique of individual sports is more frequently analyzed, specifically for cyclical sports, investigating running, throwing, swing, rowing, and swimming. And the prevailing parameters are the center of mass kinematics in match analysis and body segment object orientation. To reduce the risk of injury, sensors can provide real-time feedbacks or measure predictive factors. In terms of issues and guidelines, I will point you towards three key points in terms of issues, which the market already faces, but when you have to decide which sensors to use, it's important to bear them in mind. If you are outdoor and you need to acquire data for a long time, you need to have a good signal storing and transmission, as well as a system which is not too big to be carried on and to be used. If you are interested in water sports, of course you need waterproof devices, which fixing is not disturbing for the athlete. And in dynamic events, such as in team sports, jumping and running, fixing is a crucial point because you want to limit as much as possible the wobbling problems. The guidelines are very obvious for a scientific group of people as you are, but I just put them on because I think it's important to bear in mind that we need to stress these points when talking to new audiences that approach these sensors as a very simple and easy to use instruments. So as any instrument, they need to be quality checked in terms of ferromagnetic disturbances and in general performing spot checks in order to report the accuracy of what is obtained, and eventually perform a sensor recalibration or ask the original vendor to do so. And if joint kinematics is of interest, the anatomical calibration shouldn't be disregarded as not important, because of course the way in which the sensor is aligned with the bone, with bone morphology, has an impact on the interpretation of the information that comes out of the sensors. And already talk about fixing, but I insist on it. It's important to take care of it and to avoid cumbersome devices and areas for fixing to avoid wobbling. Of course, again, it depends on what you want to do with the sensor. If you want to track a player on the field and you have a light jacket which moves and wobbles, it doesn't really matter because you will still be able to know where the player is on the field. But if you want to know how its trunk is rotating, then it's important to fix it properly. And last but not least, data processing. It's important to acknowledge the role of gravity removal, which is not often reported and described, and use ad hoc algorithms to compensate for the bias. Many sensors do have proper filtering approaches that do the job for you, but you still need to be aware that this is an issue and that should be checked for. Because what you need what you want to do is to interpret your data within the limits set by the quality assessment that you performed. So at the end of the day, I would like to conclude giving you my perspective on the most promising way of partially fill this glass. I think that we need to combine the half-full glass of other senses in order to exploit the best part of all the sensors, such as pressure sensors or GPS, and the other sensors that in 5 years' time we will find on the screen next time. And I want to acknowledge my co-authors in this huge systematic review and thanking you for not letting your attention to drift away.